Okay, so once again, just to let you know that I am recording this lecture and we'll be putting it up on the internet. So today's topic is integration. Integration is something that we all learn about when we learn calculus in school. So these are the two basic ideas that we learn about when it comes to the integral. First, that integral is the opposite operation of taking the derivative. So it's the antiderivative. So if the integral of small f is big f, then the derivative of big f should be small f. So it is kind of the inverse operation of taking the derivative. And the second idea we learned is that the integral is the area under the graph of the function. So if you take some two points a and b, then the area under the graph of the function from a to b is the definite integral. So these are the two basic ideas that we learn about the integral. And we learn the fundamental theorem of calculus, that these two ideas are related. That you get the antiderivative by taking the definite integral from a to some x and then taking the derivative of this definite integral as you vary x. So if you take the derivative of the definite integral with respect to the upper limit, then you get the function back. So then it tells us how to construct antiderivatives. So one way is that you have a limited class of functions and then you try to check which is the antiderivative of what, right? So you can say that, you know, x square by 2 is the antiderivative, sorry, x is the antiderivative of x square by 2 and so on. So one is that you have a limited class of functions defined, say, by formula and you try to check antiderivatives. But this shows you can go beyond that. That if you know that the definite integral is a well-defined quantity, then that automatically is the antiderivative, even if you cannot give a formula for it. Right? So that extends the range. So that allows you to define many new functions. For example, the log function you can define as the definite integral from 1 to x of 1 by t dt and so on. So then functions for which you did not have formulas or names, you can define through the definite integral and then say that what is its derivative. And the other says that if you integrate the derivative of a function, you get the difference of the function. So once again, it tells you that, you know, if you take the integral of the derivative, you in a sense get the function back. So these two, the opposite directions, differentiating the integral gives you the function back, integrating the derivative gives you the function back, captures the idea that integration and differentiation are inverse function of each other, and also the first operation allows you to define entirely new kinds of functions. So this is what we do in school, but there are problems here. And these are the few problems that mathematicians faced once they started using these operations of the calculus. First of all, if you say that the integration is defined in terms of the definite integral, area under the graph of the function, then what are the functions? First of all, how you define that area? Because we know how to calculate the areas of simple figures like rectangles or circles or triangles. But for an arbitrary function, how do we even calculate the area under its graph? That is the first question. For which functions will the area under the graph be defined? Will the fundamental theorem of calculus hold for all of those functions? And finally, mathematicians in the 18th and 19th century became interested in limiting operations, and they said that, look, can I interchange the limit and the integral? If I am integrating the limit of a sequence of functions, is it okay if I integrate each of the functions and take the limit? So can I interchange the order? Because interchanging the order will allow you to calculate things which you cannot calculate otherwise. So each of these questions give difficulty to mathematicians, because let's look at the definition of the integral first. So this is the definition we learned in school, that if you want to find the area of the function between area under the graph of the function between two points A and B, divide the interval into some intervals and then form rectangles by taking some value of the function in the subinterval. And the area of the rectangles, the summed up area of the rectangles, is an approximation for the area under the graph of F. And if you make the rectangles narrower and narrower, if you reach a limit, then we declare that limit to be the area under the graph. Right? So basically, again, we are calculating by approximation. Let me say, okay, this set of rectangles that I've drawn here do not exactly capture the graph. Part of the rectangles are poking out and so on. But if you make it narrower and narrower, the parts which are missing will become smaller. So in case you get a limit, right? There's no guarantee that for each and every function, as you make the rectangles narrower and narrower, you reach a limit. But in case you do reach a limit, then that limit is worth being called the integral. And this integral nowadays we associate it with the name of Riemann. So this is the Riemann integral. Okay. Is that fine? So this is something that I assume that all of us have seen before. Is that okay? So please interrupt me at any point if you have questions. Now the Riemann integral works perfectly if you have continuous function with continuous derivatives. Then the integral is defined, the fundamental theorem of calculus works and so on. But the problem is that this set of functions, the functions which are continuous and have continuous derivatives, is not large enough for applications, because there you want to deal with discontinuous functions. And one of the ways these discontinuous functions came up was that if you take the limit of continuous functions, then the limit need not be continuous itself, right? The limit can be discontinuous. And we want to take limits freely, because you want to approximate all kinds of functions. So then the problem comes that even if you start off with data which are continuous functions with continuous derivatives, as soon as you start taking limits, you may end up with functions which don't have this properties. And while Riemann integral may be defined for some of these functions, so Riemann integral is not necessarily defined only for continuous function with continuous derivatives. It may be defined for other functions also. But in that case, all the other properties of the integral, you know, the fundamental theorem of calculus and so on, the fact that, you know, if you take the limit of an integral, it's the integral of the limit, all of them start failing. So all of them do not hold. So as time went on in the 19th century, people found that the Riemann integral was not actually adequate to the tasks of analysis. That in analysis, you want to take limits freely and you want to see that the integral behaves nicely under those limits. You want to integrate all kinds of functions. For all those tasks, the Riemann integral was inadequate. And it is part of the project which gave rise to modern measure theory is the attempt to replace the Riemann integral with something better. And that is what we are going to talk about today. Before we get into that, a few words about, you know, as I guess most of us here are students of economics, a few words about how integrals come up in our work. Right? One way that they're going to come up majorly is as mathematical expectations. So a mathematical expectation of a random variable is a weighted average or a weighted sum where the weights are probabilities. So again, in elementary probability, you learn about two cases, the discrete case, where the mathematical expectation, where discrete cases, the random variable takes on only a countable number of values. So you form the mathematical expectation by just multiplying each value by its probability and adding up. And the case where the random variable is given by a density on the real line, where you take an integral of x fx, where fx is the density. But the problem remains that what is the justification for these procedures? And these two classes where the random variable takes on only a countable number of values, and the class where the random variable has a density with respect to the real line, they are not all the random variables you can imagine. You can imagine a random variable which does not fall into any of this class. So then how do we calculate the mathematical expectation? And what ultimately is a random variable? And are all random variables going to have mathematical expectations? So what is the answer to that? The other way in which, and integral and mathematical expectation comes up again and again, for example, because in decision theory, often we model decision makers as maximizing expected utility. So you have to take the expectation of the utility. And then the random variable, which is the utility, may not fall into any of these classes. So say utility comes, think of an example in game theory, that you're looking at a Bayesian game, different types of players, each of them have a strategy, and this profile of strategy gives you a utility. So in that case, the strategy space may not be discrete, the time space may not be discrete. And therefore, we have to have a concept of expectation which can go beyond these two special cases, which can apply to a general set of random variables. The other way in which integrals come up in our work is integral as a sum. So the expression I have last in this slide, you must be familiar if you have taken a course in macro, it is a discounted utility of consumption over continuous time for a path of consumption that goes from 0 to infinity. So again, the question comes that for what kind of consumption path is this integral defined, and how are you going to calculate it? Because once again, you cannot demand that the consumption be a continuous function. Why should it be a continuous function? If the consumer can decide consumption, they can very well decide to vary their consumption in some haphazard way. So why should we restrict ourselves to the Riemann integral where the consumption is a continuous function? So for both of these kind of explicit situations, we would like a concept of integral that is defined for as broad a class as possible. So we would like to integrate, if possible, every function. And that is the goal towards which we'll go, even though it turns out in the end that we'll not be able to reach it. So now I'm stepping back from the Riemann integrals. We'll go back there, but I'm stepping back a bit and asking that, what do I want from integration? So suppose that we take these two as our model, the mathematical expectation, the probability weighted sum, or the sum of utilities over time. So if you think of an integral as some kind of an abstract weighted sum, then what kind of good quality should we ask for it? So you want a map I, which is a map on functions. So there are two arrows here. So the inner is that you have some space M over which the function is defined. So M arrow R plus is the set of functions from M to the extended real numbers. That is real number plus infinity. So we are allowing the function to take an infinite value somewhere. So you want a map which takes a function and gives you extended real number. So again, it may give you a real number and it may give you infinity. So it's a map on functions. So you feed a function into it and a number will come out. And again, ideally, we would like this map to work on all functions, that you can feed any function into it and it will give a number. But we'll see that will not happen. We'll have to restrict the domain on which it works. So all these things in gray, you can take as bubbles from the future. So we would not like these restrictions to be there. But ultimately, for a consistent and useful theory, we will have to put in these restrictions. So for the time being, we want a function which takes a function f and gives you a number, a real number. And we want it to have the following properties. That if you have a measurable set A, then one A, remember, is the function which is 1 on A and 0 outside of A. So if you feed that function into your integral object, then it should give you mu A. Why? Because again, look at the case of expectations. So you have some set of events, some event A, right? Some set of outcomes A. And your function which is 1 when those outcomes happen, and 0 when the outcomes don't happen. So what is the mathematical expectation? The mathematical expectation is 1 times the probability of the event plus 0 times the probability of the complement. But that's 0 times something, so it goes out. So you're left with mu A. So if your integral function I has to behave like mathematical expectation, then I of 1A has to be mu A. Or think on the real line. So the real line is going, there is some set A, and there's a function which is 1 on A and 0 outside. So it is like a step function. So what is the area under the curve? Wherever the curve is non-zero, its height is 1. So the area under the curve will be height times width. So height is 1, width is the length of A. So again, the area under the curve should be the length of A. Right? So IA is called an indicator function, a function which is 1 on the set A and 0 outside. So we are saying that the integral of the indicator function should be the measure of the set for which it is the indicator. Then we want linearity, that if you multiply by a scalar and if you add up, then the answer should add. And again, it is coming from the idea of expectation or the area under a curve, that if you have, say, two functions and you want the sum of the area under both, then it should be area under one plus the area under the other. If you scale up or scale down the function, the area should scale up or scale down in the same way. So you want the function I to which you give some functions and it gives you an area or expectation. We want it to be linear. We want it to be monotonic, that if some function is larger than another function, then the expectation or area under the curve will also be larger, right? Because if you have a graph and the other graph, so you have a graph of G and the graph of F is always above G, then the area under the graph of F should be more than the area under the graph of G. And so on. And finally, we want continuity, that if you have a sequence of functions converging to F, then its integral should also converge to the integral of f. So again, we will see that this hope will not be entirely fulfilled, that this will not happen in general. We'll have to put some restrictions. But this is what we would like, that if you're going to approximate some function f by a sequence of function fn, then the integral should go continuously from the integral of fn to the integral of f. So this is like a program that we would like to figure out a mapping I with all these properties. Then we would say that this mapping is worth being called an integral or an expectation. So our job is to construct this mapping for as large a possible set of functions here and as large or as wide a definition of continuity as possible. So what Lebesgue did, so this integral that we'll develop is called the Lebesgue integral after the French mathematician Lebesgue, who developed it in the early part of the 20th century. What Lebesgue did was actually to deliver on this program. So Lebesgue gave you a function I, which works for a large class of functions and which has a very good continuity properties, which will satisfy this program. And what Lebesgue's definition of the integral was, is what we are going to do. So any questions, comments? Okay, so how did Lebesgue do it? So what we'll do is, we'll do it in steps. So we'll define the integral for simple functions. I'm going to define what's a simple function. Then from the integral of simple functions, we'll go to the integral of non-negative functions. And from non-negative functions, we'll go to the integral of general real value function. So what is a simple function? A simple function is that you have some collection, finite collection of measurable sets, disjoint, and you have some real numbers, and a simple function takes on a value which is a constant over a particular set. So it is ci over ai, so c1 over a1, c2 over a2. So it is sort of a step function. So over one entire set, its value does not change. Okay. So now, remember what happens. We said that if the function has a value 1 over an entire set, its value should be mu a, and it should be linear. So if you want the first and the second properties, consistency with the measure and linearity, then you have no choice but to define the integral of a simple function by this formula, that it is the sum of ci mu ai. Why? Because see, if it had been 1 over ai, then its integral should have to have been mu ai to satisfy the first requirement, consistency with the measure. If you multiply it by ci, so instead of 1, its value is ci, that's just like multiplying by ci, then the integral of that part should be ci mu ai. Now you can think of this step function as the sum total of this kind of scaled indicator functions. So then by the linearity, the integral of the simple function must be the sum of the integral of each of these scaled indicators. So I could have actually introduced a earlier step, a scaled indicator. So a scaled indicator is just like an indicator, but instead of taking the value 1 on the set, it takes the value ci on the set. And then I could have written Sx as the sum of n scaled indicators. So ci 1 ai plus c1 1 a1 plus c2 1 a2 and so on. And then if I have to have consistency with the measure and linearity in my definition of the integral, then I have to define the integral of a step function in this way. Okay. So I don't have much choice in this definition. This has to be the definition. One tricky issue which will come up is that either ci or mu ai may turn out to be infinite. So mu ai of course will not be infinite in the probability case, but see, on the real line you can have an ai which has length infinity. So in measure theory, we'll always assume that if you have a product of infinity and zero, then the answer is zero. So we'll assume that if you have a function which is zero on an infinite set, then the area under the curve will take it to be zero. Or if you have a function which is has an infinite value on a set of length 0, then the area under the curve is again 0. So this is a kind of free choice, but if you make the opposite choice, that infinite times 0 is infinity, then you will get a much less useful theory, a useless theory kind of. Whereas if you take the choice infinity times 0 is equal to 0, you get a much more useful theory. So this will be important later when we think of unbounded functions or unbounded sets and so on. But this is something which is we built in at the starting level in our definition of the integral. That if you have an infinite valued function which is infinite only on a set of measure 0, its integral is 0. If you have a function which is 0 valued over a set of measure infinity, its integral is again taken to be 0. Okay, so an example. So Sx is a function 1 if x is rational and 0 if x is irrational. So first of all, we'll have to make sure that this falls into a definition of a simple function. So the simple function, so the set of rationals is disjoint from the set of irrationals. But is the set of rationals measurable? Well, it turns out it is, and it has measure zero. How do we do that? Well, remember, whenever I say Lebesgue measure, I'm talking about the measure on the real line I got by starting off with half closed intervals, taking the measure to be the length, and then doing the Carthéodory extension theorem on it to get move it to a sigma algebra. So that is the Lebesgue measure. So I'm going to argue that any point, rational or irrational, has measure zero. Why? Because just take this semi-open intervals x to x plus 1 by n. So if you take the intersection of all of these, then the only thing which can survive, so you have x on the left and 1 by n on the right, and 1 by n is shrinking in, x is always there. So in this full intersection, the thing which will remain is only x. So this is a countable intersection. Now, what is the length of the interval? The nth interval has length 1 by n. So, and these intervals are shrinking. So it's a monotonically decreasing and decreasing down to something. So the limit of the length is going to zero. So then the length of the point by itself is also going to be zero, right? Which is what you would expect. So it's kind of obvious, but here we have proved it from the axioms. So we have taken a decreasing sequence of intervals whose length is going to zero and whose intersection is x. And therefore the singleton set will have a length zero. Now, we discussed in an earlier lecture that the set of rational numbers is countable. So, the set of rational numbers Q can be taken as a countable union of singletons, right? So, you take each of these rationals and take a countable union. And each singleton is disjoint from another singleton. So, by countable additivity, you are adding up a countable number of set of measure zero, right? And so, the rational set is both a measurable set and it has a set of measure zero. The set of irrationals, right? Okay, is also a measurable set. Why? Because it is the complement of the set of rationals. And we said that the Lebesgue measure is defined on a sigma algebra. And the sigma algebra, the complement of any set in the sigma algebra is also in the sigma algebra. So the set of irrationals is complement of the set of rationals. And what's its measure? Its measure is 1. Right? So now again, you see the importance of restricting additivity to only the countable case. Because see, the irrational set is also consisting of singletons only, right? You have a lot of singletons, but now you have an uncountable number of singletons. So you cannot prove that the set of irrationals has measure zero because there is no countable union which contains all irrationals as against the rationals which are countable, right? So the rationals, we can use the fact that the singleton has measure zero and take a countable union and say that the entire set of rationals has measure zero, but not so for the irrationals. The irrationals have measure one if I am considering the interval 0 to 1. Now the integral of S with respect to the Lebesgue measure is 1 times the measure of the rationals, but the measure of the rationals is 0, plus 0 times the measure of irrationals. So the measure of irrationals is 1, but it's 0 times 1, so it's 0. So the integral is well defined because S is a simple function and its integral value is 0. So this is an example of applying the definition from the previous case, that if I have a function which takes on constants on two sets, each of which is measurable, then I just take the constant times the measure of each of those sets and add it up. But the interesting part is that this S is a function which is not Riemann integrable. Why? Because if you try to draw the graph of S, I don't think even that saying draw the graph of X makes sense, because on the unit interval, the rationals and the irrationals are closely mixed with each other, right? Close to every rational is an irrational, close to every irrational is a rational. So if you try to imagine the graph of S, it keeps zigzagging between 0 and 1, right? So if you try to approximate it by rectangles, the approximations will never converge. Because between any interval, however short, it keeps jumping between 0 and 1. So the lower limit of the approximation will be 0, the upper limit will be 1, and the lower and upper limit, even if you make the subintervals finer and finer and finer, you'll always have oscillations between 0 and 1. And so the integral, so the rectangles areas will never converge, however fine you make the subintervals. So this is the first example of a function which is not integrable by the Riemann definition, but which is integrable by our new definition. Right? So our new definition is still, in the process of being created. It is so far defined only for these simple functions, but already we have been able to integrate one function which the Riemann definition could not integrate. So any questions, comments? Now you can say, is this even a function? Right? Because, I mean, where will this come up? That it's one on rational and zero when it's irrational and so on. And the 19th century again saw a lot of debate about this. Because if you start off with, say, Newton and so on, when calculus was just starting off, then people thought of as functions as given by formulas. And at best, you may have cases that, okay, this formula holds when x is less than 1, that formula holds when x is greater than 1. And that is how the function concept began. And then people would say that, you know, something like this really is taking it too far. It's not even a function. Because there's no formula. Where did this come from? You cannot draw a graph. You cannot visualize the graph and so on. And therefore, there was a lot of struggle as the definition of function was extended. Today, we are kind of indoctrinated that from early school, we are taught that function is any mapping, that, you know, any kind of association of points on x-axis to points on y-axis, as long as each x has a particular y, that's a function. But lot of, you know, great mathematicians of the early history of calculus would have been horrified that, you know, what are you calling a function, and is there anything at all you can say about functions in this much generality? The reason mathematicians were forced to accept this general notion of function is twofold. First, something that we already kind of hinted at, that even if you begin with functions which are very nice in terms of, you know, being defined by formulas and so on, as soon as you start taking limits, you will be thrown out of that nice set. So once you allow that, you know, functions can be defined by limiting operations, then you can no longer claim that the result has to be have a formula or the result has to be nice in some sense. Because nice functions have as a limit functions which are not nice. Continuous functions can have a limit which is not continuous. Differentiability, don't even forget about it. So that was one thing which motivated the general acceptance of the function. The other was that, you know, when you're modeling physical reality, then you feel that your theory should apply to any kind of functions, physical reality, social reality, any kind of reality. So like one of the things which early calculus was trying to analyze is the basic equations of physics. And one simple problem was that, say, the fluctuations of a guitar string, that you take the string in any initial position and let it go, and how will it fluctuate? How will it vibrate? So then people argued that, you know, the initial shape of the string should be anything. I can twist and turn the string in any form, not be given by a formula. And the theory of the vibration of the guitar string should work for any such initial shape. Why should your initial shape be given by a nice formula? Why should it even be differentiable? If I just pick the string, then it's like a triangle. It's not differentiable, but the guitar still plays, right? So the theory of the guitar should also play. Why should it be restricted to nice functions? Or the other problem, which was the famous problem which motivated a lot of analysis in this period, conduction of heat, that you have two plates and you put some temperature, or say you have just one plate, one metal plate, and you put some temperature on the corners of the plate and you see how the temperature inside the plate evolves. So again, I am free to do whatever and put whatever temperature on the corners of the plate. Why should it be a simple function, edges of the plate? So all this, both the physical fact that the initial conditions or the boundary conditions of lot of physical problems which we are trying to analyze could be any function, and the fact that within mathematics itself, once you allow for unrestricted use of limiting process, to go from nice functions to not so nice functions, both of these motivated the desire to allow for function in its fullest generality, the definition that we learn today. But the fears of people who oppose this generality were also right, that at this generality, there is pretty much little that you can say about functions. So in the end, we'll have to again restrict the kind of functions we can talk about. But the restrictions then we'll apply case by case. For each theory or each problem we are discussing, we'll say that, okay, this works only for this kind of functions. And we'll try to make that class as large as possible. But the function concept itself, we are leaving unrestricted. So then nowadays we have no trouble in talking about Sx is equal to 1 if x is rational and 0 if x is irrational. Okay. So our next step in defining the integral is for non-negative functions. So if you have a function fx, then you define the integral of f, so it's non-negative, could have a value infinity, as the supremum, supremum remember is the least upper bound of the integral of all simple functions which are less at each point than fx. So basically whose graph is below the graph of fx. So the motivation here is again to have the integral as the area under the graph. But how do I get the area under the graph? So I already know how to calculate the area under a simple function. So I say take all the simple functions which whose graph will be below the graph of this f and take the supremum over all of them, right? So again, I can, you know, take more and more complicated simple functions to fill up the area better and better. So the diagram I have here, the simple function is leaving out a lot of the area. But I can say, okay, split it up, make it higher here, a bit higher here, and so on. And you can have a better approximation. So again, this is not a recipe for calculation. I'm not saying that, you know, necessarily take the supremum like this. But this is a definition that I can have the entire class of simple functions whose graph lie below the graph of f. And the supremum of that I define as the integral of f. Okay. This diagram is very misleading because this Sx I have drawn, it's the sets over which the simple function is defined are nice rectangles. But the whole point of Lebesgue theory is that your simple functions can be defined over sets which are much, much weirder than rectangles, which is why I did this example with rational and irrational. So this is also a simple function, but as I said, its graph will be a crazy graph to draw. You cannot even draw it nicely, right? Because it keeps zigzagging. So Lebesgue theory has more power than Riemann theory, precisely because the graph by which you can approximate, or the areas by which you are approximating the area under the graph, can be much more irregular. So you can approximate areas under much more irregular functions. So by allowing any measurable set in the definition of simple function and making our set of measurable sets really large in definition of the Lebesgue measure, I can approximate functions which Riemann cannot even approach, which is what this example shows. That if you are restricted to approximating by just rectangles, then you have to give up on this function. You cannot integrate this function. But if you can approximate by simple functions, which are the finite sum of indicators, scaled indicators of Lebesgue measurable sets, because the supply of Lebesgue measurable sets is so much larger, you can integrate many more functions. And that is what's going to give this theory its power. Okay, so any questions so far? Well, now comes the first setback. That while I can define integral like this for any non-negative function, if you allow your domain of integration to be all non-negative functions, then the other nice properties about, you know, additivity, linearity, continuity, they will not hold. So to have those properties hold, we will have to restrict ourselves to a limited class of functions. And that class of functions is known as measurable functions. So given a measurable space, so measurable space means that you have some underlying space M and a sigma algebra script M on M. A function M to R plus is defined to be measurable if for any lambda, the set X where Fx is less than or equal to lambda belongs to the sigma algebra. Right? So basically Fx less than or equal to lambda, the set where X is less than lambda, we should have a measure for that set. So it should not be so irregular that it does not belong to the class of sets to which we have assigned a measure. Is that okay? So, and that should be true for any lambda. So you're thinking of slicing. So think of where is this set coming from? That you have the graph of the function and you slice it at lambda. And the slice, when you look at where what you have left on the x-axis, that is the set of x where fx is less than or equal to lambda. And so we are saying that the projection of each slice on the x-axis should be a measurable set. Should be the set on which you have assigned a measure. If that happens for each and every slice, then we say that f is a measurable function. Now there are other equivalent ways of defining measurability. So if it's less than or equal to lambda belongs to M, then greater than lambda will also belong to M because it's just the complement, right? And we said that M is a sigma algebra. So if a set belongs, then its complement also belongs. Just less than lambda will also belong because it can be written as a countable intersection of sets in the sigma algebra. If less than lambda belongs, then greater than or equal to lambda will also belong by complementation. And you can turn this all around. So if less than lambda belongs, then again all four will belong as so on. So one can use one definition or other, whichever is convenient, but some restriction we have to put on the function. It should not be so irregular that fx less than or equal to lambda, right, is a set which we cannot measure at all. Okay. Fine. And we'll see that our integral will have good properties only when we restrict it to the space of measurable functions. Now, this is bad news because it turns out that there are functions which are not measurable. So your integral is not going to be defined for all functions. On the other hand, the news is not very bad because there is a huge supply of measurable functions. So the indicator of any measurable set is measurable. If two functions are measurable, then any scalar multiple, sum, product, max, mean are measurable. Lim sup, lim inf, and limit of sequence of measurable functions are measurable. So if you're not familiar with lim sup and lim inf, I will define it in a moment. Limit, I'm sure you're all familiar with. So if you take a sequence of measurable functions and it has a limit, pointwise limit, then that's also measurable. A continuous transformation of a measurable function is measurable. On the Lebesgue measure, all continuous functions are measurable. And then of course, sum of continuous function, limit of continuous function, lim sup of continuous function, all of them are measurable. But in both our big examples, the Lebesgue measure and the infinite coin toss, there are functions which are not measurable. So yes, you have a good supply. And if you start off with nice functions, then the standard operations will leave you inside the set of measurable functions, right? So for example, we said that the limit of continuous functions may not be continuous, but the limit of measurable functions will be measurable and so on. So measurability has much more stability that all the standard operations, you start off with measurable functions, you will still be left with measurable functions. But still something is left out. However, if you restrict to measurable functions, then you have consistency with measure, you have linearity, you have monotonicity. We don't have general continuity, but we have continuity for monotone sequences, right? So this should remind you of the continuity property of measures, that if you have a monotone sequence of sets, then the limit of the measure is measure of the limit. Same about functions, that if you have non-negative functions, which are increasing, so for each point, so it should not be f1s, f1x is less than or equal to f2x is less than or equal to and so on. So it's a sequence of functions which is limiting at, which is increasing at each point. And if it is increasing, then you know that increasing sequence have a limit, possibly infinity. So if you allow in infinity to have a limit, then you have continuity. That the limit of integral is the integral of the limit. So we'll see that for general functions, the continuity will not hold. But for increasing sequence of non-negative measurable functions, the continuity of the integral holds. That you can interchange the limit and the integral. That whether you integrate and take the limit, or take the limit and integrate, you will get the same answer. So this is the biggest victory of the Lebesgue theorem, that finally we have a definition of integral, which at least for this case, and we'll see that this leads to other limit theorems. So at least in many useful cases, allows you to interchange the limit and the integral. So two gains, one is this one. And the other gain is that the set of measurable functions is much, much larger than just the set of continuous functions. So therefore, our integral is defined over many more functions and still has the good properties we want from it. Okay. Is that okay? Any questions? So for a second, let's go back to one of our earlier slides, where we are saying where integration comes up. So now we can answer. So we can say, what is a random variable? So somehow, you know, in interview panels for admission where I sit, this seems to be a very popular question. A random variable is, what is a random variable? And you say that a random variable, the official answer, the expected answer, is that a random variable is a function on the sample space. Now we amend it a little and we say a random variable is a measurable function on the sample space. So that is the official definition of the random variable. For the second question, that which kind of convolution paths can you calculate this integral? So if you assume that u is a continuous function, then you can say that for every measurable consumption path, I can calculate this integral. So I need not restrict my consumers to only having continuous consumption path. I can say that as long as the consumption path is measurable, I can calculate the integral. Now, a doubt comes. The doubt is that in both cases, this word measurable has crept in and it has nothing to do with our intuition, right? So in the admission interview, when we ask what is a random variable, the people usually often answer, or at least initially answer. If you give them a hint, then they will say it's a function on the sample space. I don't know anyone who has said measurable function on the sample space. But the intuition that we start off with is that a random variable is a variable which fluctuates, right? So it's a function on the sample space. So this restriction on measurability is imposed on us as a kind of technical restriction, that without measurability, our integral is not going to work. But in applications, often we cannot map it to anything which is there in the application. So if you say, why should a consumption function be measurable, right? If a consumption is a choice, I can make that choice anyhow. So why should I say that my consumer choose only a measurable path? Why should my random variable be measurable and so on? So there is a kind of tension here that we are putting a restriction on the kind of, say, consumption paths we are allowing, which is not motivated by your application at all. And it's a genuine tension. Some people have tried to got out of it by, you know, not requiring measurability and giving up on the integral. So defining the utility in some other way. But that's a very radical kind of step. I would like to say, yes, measurability by itself is directly not motivable. But again, you think that, you know, consumers, can they really choose any function on an infinite, you know, interval? Really not. Because this whole continuous time itself is approximation, right? The fact is that when I decide, I am not changing my decision continuously. I am only changing at some discrete set of intervals and so on. Okay. Maybe even if I say that, you know, I am someone who changes their consumption minute by minute, a minute is still an interval, it's not a point. So then I can say that most likely the consumption is actually a piecewise constant function that is constant for some time, then it changes and so on. But because I don't want to deal with that mess, I allow and I really don't know how soon it changes and when it changes. So I don't want to impose a discrete time setting on it. But then I can say that any real consumption function will actually be much nicer function than an arbitrary measurable function. So in allowing for measurable function, I have actually taken into account all consumption functions which can really come up. So you say that the continuum or a continuous probability space is anyway an idealization. Any real phenomena does not happen on the continuum, right? And therefore, any real function which comes up in an application is very likely to be quite a simple function, and therefore it will be a part of the measurable function, right? Okay. So in a way, you can say that, you know, we are working in idealization because things are easy to calculate. But anyway, the actual realizations would be in a very more much more reasonable subset. So one way that I look at it, one example that sometimes come up in my mind is that if you think of real numbers, so I say consumption is a real number, right? But if you go to the RBI website and look up the consumption, it will always be a fraction. And in fact, it will be a fraction with a few decimal places, right? So it will be some 100.2 million rupees or billion rupees or whatever. So it's actually a fraction with a very small denominator. So we assume that consumption is a real number because then we can easily do approximation limits and so on. But any actual value of consumption actually is rational, and it's a rational with a small denominator. So nothing is really lost in assuming that your functions you're dealing with are measurable. Right? So this is a debatable point. This is a point that requires reflection because the mathematics is quite clear. That if you have measurable function, everything works. But are we justified in limiting our domain to measurable function where the application of the mathematics is concerned? And here, this is a defense I have given, but you may or may not be convinced by that defense. So any questions, comments? Now, why do we restrict our convergence to monotone convergence? So here is a small example. So it's set in the coin toss universe. So I say fn omega is a function which has the value 2 to the power of n if the first to the nth toss in omega are heads. So the first n tosses are heads, you get 2 to the power of n rupees. Otherwise, you get 0. So think of it as a kind of lottery. So what is the mathematical expectation? So fn, calculating the mathematical expectation, fn is very easy. Because it's 2 to the power of n only if the first n tosses are heads. So that has the probability 2 to the power of minus n. So it's 2 to the power of n plus 2 to the power of into 2 to the power of minus n plus 0 into something. So it's just 1. So integral of fn is 1. On the other hand, if I take n to infinity, then what happens? Then in any omega, if there's a tail, then say the tail is at the 100th position, then f100 onwards, f100 is 0 because the first 100s are not heads, the 100th is tail. f101 is 0 because again, in the first 101 tosses, the 100th one is a tail. f102 is 0 and so on. So if there's a tails anywhere, say if there's a tail in the tth position, then ft onwards would be 0. So fn would converge to 0. On the other hand, if the sequence of tosses is all heads, right? That's also a logical possibility. Then you'll get a larger and larger and larger prize, right? So if it's all heads, then in the first f1 will give you 2, f2 will give you 4, f3 will give you 8. So fn omega, sorry, again, there's a typo here. This should be just f omega, the limit is equal to infinity if all the tosses are heads and it is 0 otherwise. So if you take the integral of f, right, then it's infinity into what is the probability of all tosses being heads? It is just one singleton, so it has probability 0. So it's infinity into 0. And we agreed on the convention that infinity into 0 is going to be 0. So integral of f d mu is infinity times 0, which we have taken by convention to be 0, plus 0 into something. So the whole thing is 0. So now you can see that there's a discontinuity, that the integral of every fn is 1. So the limit of the integrals exists and it's equal to 1. But the integral of the limit is 0, right? Okay. So the general continuity we cannot hope for. These are very simple functions, but even then, the limit and the integral, if you interchange, you'll get different answers. If you take the limit and integrate, you'll get 0. If you integrate and take the limit, you will get 1. Okay. So we cannot hope for continuity across every sequence. This is okay. Let's take a look. There's a typo here. The second displayed equation should be f omega is equal to infinity or 0. Sorry, there's a mistake. I've written f and omega. Okay, what's happening here? What's happening is that fn omega takes on a higher and higher value on a smaller and smaller set. So it takes 2. So f1 omega takes the value 2 on a set with probability half, the first one being head. F2 omega takes 1 by 4th on the second being on a set of probability 1 4th and so on. Sorry, f2 takes the value 4 on a set of probability 1 by 4 and so on. So it's kind of picking up. It's becoming larger and larger on a smaller and smaller set. So it's like becoming like a needle. And that's what's happening, that all the probability is kind of escaping to that singleton. What do we do about it? So we'll have to put either, we'll have to weaken the conclusion. So this conclusion that limit n tends to infinity fn d mu is f d mu, this conclusion cannot hold in general. So there are two ways out. Either we weaken the conclusion or we strengthen the hypothesis, and both work. So weakening the conclusion is Fatou's lemma, which says that if you have a sequence, so now we are not saying it's a monotonic sequence, it's an arbitrary sequence of non-negative measurable functions, then the integral of the limit is less than or equal to the limit of the integral. So limit of a sequence is the supremum over all n of the infimum for k greater than n ak, right? So if you have not seen it before, just give it a moment's thought. So infimum k greater than n ak is saying the infimum of a certain tail of the sequence. So AK is a sequence, AN is a sequence. So you look at the elements after the NN and say, what's the infimum? So basically as K grow, as N grows, then this infimum can only become larger because you're looking at a smaller and smaller set of sequence. And supremum of that is called the limit. So liminf is, you can think of this as the ultimate infimum. So there may be, you know, some points initially which you drop, but after dropping some finite number of points, the infimum which will remain. So ultimately, what doesn't it, you know, go below? So the ultimate lower bound in some rough sense, the strict sense is this definition. Rough sense is the ultimate lower bound of the sequence. So we say that the ultimate lower bound, if you integrate it, it's less than or equal to the ultimate lower bound of the integrals. So for a sequence which actually has a limit, the liminf, and there's a mirror image definition of a limsup, the liminf and the limsup is exactly equal to the limit. So our example here is fine, because the liminf of the fn is the same as the limit f. So integral of the liminf is 0. And liminf of the integral, so integrals of fn is 1. So liminf of the integral is 1. So if you apply Fatou's lemma to our example, the left hand side will be 0, the right hand side will be 1. So the Fatou's lemma still holds. So the Fatou's lemma is verified with our example also. So instead of equality, if you are willing to settle for an inequality, then you can apply it to sequences, even which are non-monotonic, even which may not converge, because even for a non-convergent sequence, the lim inf is going to be defined. And turns out that even this little much of information is often enough for many applications. So even having an inequality and even having in terms of lim inf is actually a useful thing to have. So Fatou's lemma is actually an important lemma. For the next convergence theorem, I have to define the integral for general functions, not necessarily non-negative. So far everything has been non-negative. This is a general function. So for any general real valued measurable function, I define f plus to be max f0, right? So whenever f becomes negative, the max will just drop f and give you 0. So basically it's a function which is clipped at the x-axis, that whenever it goes below the x-axis, I just clip it to 0. And if it is above the x-axis, then it takes the actual value. So it is the positive part of the function. F minus, you kind of first flip it, so that you take minus f, so the negative becomes positive becomes negative, and again you clip it at the x-axis, and so it becomes a negative part. And we say that if both of them are finite, then I'm going to define the integral to be the integral of the positive part. So the good thing is that f positive and f plus and f minus, both are non-negative functions, so their integral is already defined by a previous thing. So then I define it to be the integral of the positive part minus the integral of the negative part. Okay. If both of them are infinity, I don't try to define the integral, because I may get into inconsistencies by trying to do infinity. So if both of them are finite, only then do I subtract and I define the function. I define the integral to be the integral of the positive part minus the integral of the negative part. Saying that both of these are finite, you can also say that the integral of the mod of this is finite, right? Because the mod of this has a finite integral. Mod of this is the integral of the positive part plus the integral of the negative part. So if it is finite, then both of them are finite. So we say such a function is integrable and its integral is defined. So the final and very important convergence theorem is the dominated convergence theorem. So the monotonic convergence and Fatou's lemma apply only to non-negative functions. Dominated convergence applies to any functions. It says that if you have a sequence which converges to f, again, the convergence need not be monotonic. But now we say that there is a function g with a finite integral and all fn is less than g. So each of this fn is less than g. Then the limit is integrable, and actually you can interchange limits and integration. So if the entire sequence is bounded throughout by this one single function g whose integral is finite, then I am again allowed to interchange limits and integration. So you can check that in our coin toss example, where I was giving 2 to the power of n, where the first n tosses are heads. In that example, you can never construct a g such that if each fn is less than g and g is integrable, there is no such g. Right? And therefore, you cannot apply the dominated convergence theorem, which is a good thing, because in that case, we know that the conclusion does not hold. So it's good that the hypothesis also does not hold, otherwise this would not be a theorem. But of course, it is one of the famous theorems, it's a theorem. So the hypothesis will not hold in our example. But in situations where you can make the hypothesis hold, even for an arbitrary real valued function with arbitrary convergence, not necessarily monotone convergence, you are allowed to interchange limits and integration. One final result, which I don't have on my slide, but which is very important, is that this new notion of integral that we have now defined for all measurable functions, this is the extension of the Riemann integral in two ways. That every Riemann integral integrable function is Lebesgue integrable, and if the function is, and the integrals values would be the same, the value of the Riemann integral and the value of the Lebesgue integral would be the same as long as the function is Riemann integral. So in a way, Lebesgue integral is a kind of conservative extension. It agrees with the Riemann integral wherever the Riemann integral gives you an answer, but it can integrate many more functions and it has much nicer properties compared to the Riemann. One thing which I am leaving out completely from this set of lectures is what happened to the fundamental theorem of calculus. That with this new notion of integral, is the derivative and the integral still opposite operations of each other? And it turns out that that was one of the great victories of this new theory, that it actually give a very good and nice, you know, conclusion to this whole fundamental theory of calculus today. But just because of lack of time, I'm not doing it. All standard measure theory books will cover this relation between the integral and the derivative once you define the integral in the limit sense. So any questions, comments on the entire lecture? Well, thank you then. So I will stop here for today, and we'll meet next again on Wednesday to talk about conditional.